All right, guys. So here we are for a TNA Impact Wrestling review. Something I haven't done for quite a while now. It used to be more of a weekly thing for me. I used to do Impact reviews just about every week, and now these last couple of months, haven't really had too much of an opportunity to do one. Even now, it's Friday afternoon, and I'm still doing it way later than I want to. But I'm actually going to do an Impact review for this week, because I said I was going to, so I might as well live up to what I say and do it. So, TNA started off with Bully Ray, the Aces and Eights, being outside, security trying to stop them, and then they basically just forced their way into the Impact Zone, even though it's not the Impact Zone anymore. They are on the road now, which is great. So James Storm comes to the ring with AJ Styles standing in the crowd, basically just looking on, silently standing there, still not saying much of anything after all these weeks of, you know, speculation, what's AJ going to do, kind of questioning what he's going to, whose side he's going to be on. So basically, Storm says that AJ was the better man last week, but he ain't crying over it. He's here to talk about the Aces and Eights, wants to kick some ass tonight. Bad Influence come out, a.k.a. Kaz and Daniels, who are awesome. So they come out and they say that, you know, for tell Jimbo to shut up, that TNA, the only thing TNA needs to stop the Aces and Eights is the reuniting of Fortune. They just need AJ to get down here and join his friends. And this is, you know, their crude, humorous type of way on the mic is just awesome. These two guys are fantastic together. Storm just tells them that nobody gives a shit and they should shut the hell up. And they call him irrelevant, and then they get in a fight, and then Storm ends up getting the shit beat out of him, and the Aces and Eights come down. It looks like they're about to beat, you know, put Storm through a table. But then all of a sudden, Joseph Park to the rescue at Park. he comes to the rescue, knocks down a couple Aces and Eights guys, but ends up the numbers game ends up getting to him. Then he gets 3D'd through a table, which is pretty cool. First time I've seen a 3D in a long time. And Styles just looks on from the crowd, yet no real, you know, word as to whether, you know, what he's, whose side he's on. So I guess we'll have to continue to tune in to find out just who AJ Styles is associated with. Like I've always been saying, I've been saying it since basically the beginning, I don't think he's really going to end up taking a side. I think he's just, you know, in for himself and that's it. But then again, I can't really tell. So again, keeps you interested. A decent opening segment, I guess you could say. They have a commercial. They come back. Aces and Eights are still in the ring. Bully talks about all their destruction, how they've taken out every single last hero. And none of those heroes appeared on tonight's show, which was effective, in my opinion. It made it, like, noticeable that those guys weren't here. Like, we took these guys out, but they're not just back the next week. Because that's what they've ineffectively done, in my opinion, throughout the course of the Aces and Eights, is because when you really think about it, if you're taking people out, they shouldn't be able to come back within 2 or 3 weeks. They should be out for a while. And they've done that effectively so far with Hardy. He gets taken out of the stretcher. He hasn't been seen ever since. Hopefully he's out for at least a few more weeks. Maybe he doesn't return until Slammiversary in June. That's a whole nother, you know, month and a half still I'm going to be there. But it's still a whole nother month plus, you know, till then. Bully then goes on to talk about calling out Hogan. He wants a response from him by the end of the show. So that's basically going to be your main event, is the Hogan-Bully Ray confrontation. And probably your main event for Slammiversary, brother. Where I win the world title, dude. Let's hope not. But remember, that rumor has been there. First match of the evening was a knockouts match. We had two knockouts matches tonight. One for the belt, one just a singles match. Taryn Terrell takes on Tara. Taryn Terrell is my, like, oh my god. Taryn Terrell is making me happy, man. Every time I see her on that TV, holy shit. God, is she beautiful. And then she's facing Tara, who's also, I'm just like, oh, who do I cheer for in this one? Taryn Terrell ends up winning with a schoolgirl. When Tara gets a little too cocky, Tara dominated the better part of the match, as a heel should. Told a pretty good story. Taryn Terrell gets the victory. She also is beating Gail Kim, so apparently they are going to push her. Looks like she'll probably end up with the Knockouts belt very soon. And then again, basically everybody wins the Knockouts belt. just like in WWE, basically everybody wins the Divas belt at one point. It's kind of the same, except this division is much better, and they give this match about 10 minutes of TV time, which is really impressive. I give TNA credit for that. Wasn't too bad of a match, wasn't amazing by any means, but it wasn't bad, and they give their women time, so I appreciate that. It's not as good as it was a couple of years ago, but they're still giving their women attention. They just came out with a new website for them. Get to look at pictures of gorgeous women. There's nothing wrong with that. This match wasn't that bad, and Taryn Terrell wins. Fuck yeah. And that's about all I got to say about that, so I'm not upset by any means. So Robbie E talks to Jesse Goddard and tells him he needs to beat Robbie T tonight, and if he does, he'll be one of the best bros of all time. So that automatically sets you up to believe that the next match is going to be Rob Terry and Jesse Goddard. And we all both know how both these guys just aren't real good wrestlers at all, and no one really cares about either one of these guys. I mean, as much as Rob Terry's impressive with his, you know, physique, I don't really care about his wrestling. Jesse Goddard's is just a flash in the pan. No one gives a fuck, ever, never did. They still ask who the fuck he is. Still, I don't even know who the fuck he is. Rob Terry goes over very, very easily. I don't know. I don't like this at all. They're like, oh, Rob Terry's so impressive now that he's on his own. It's like, dude, he held your mid-card belt for like 4 or 5 months in 2010. Don't you remember that? God damn it. It's like, I don't understand this company. It's like they just forget about the fact that Rob Terry already has won a belt in TNA and has been on his own multiple times before. And they're like, oh, no, this is the first time he's ever... It's like, dude... His association with Robbie E, if anything, it just brought him down because Robbie E sucks. And Robbie Terry, I never really was a fan of anyway because he's just a big guy. He can do like 4 power moves. So I don't care about him. I don't care about any of this. It's filler crap to me. Meant nothing. So Bad Influence are backstage trying to convince Bobby Roode, because they're fighting for the tag belts again, Aries and Roode, against Chavo and Hernandez. And not like we haven't seen that match a million fucking times. But they're trying to convince Roode to rejoin Fortune so they can take out the Aces and Eights, while Aries is like the fly on the wall listening. And he confronts him about it before their tag title match. And by the way, Chris Sabin is going to be returning, which I think is an amazing story that TNA can really capitalize on. They probably could have capitalized on it the entire way. They could have tried to document his road to recovery. But I mean, again, you know, TNA had no way of really truly knowing if Sabin was even ever going to come back. I personally had no clue if he was ever going to be able to come back because he tore his ACL once. Then the next year he comes back, wrestles a couple of matches, tears it again. I don't know if it was the same leg, other leg, whatever. 2 torn ACLs, very, very difficult to come back from even one, never mind 2. I give this guy maximum credit for even trying to come back, you know, again. I hope he can make it. I hope he does. He's a great competitor. The Motor City Machine Guns were great when they were around. It's too bad Shelly's gone, but Sabin can still be a great X Division star, potential champion. He's already been champion before and was a great one. So I am totally okay with Chris Sabin coming back. I can't wait to see him come back. I hope he's careful, and I hope he doesn't get hurt again. He's a great competitor that's always been true to TNA for a long time. He deserves, you know, he deserves to be able to have a comeback. I'm almost surprised to hear about it, but I'm glad. I'm looking forward to that. So Chavo and Hernandez face Aries and Roode for the tag belts. Good match. Daniels and Kaz were at commentary doing pretty enjoyable commentary, to be honest with you, throughout it. We got a little break from Mike Tenay during this segment too, so there's no problem with that. Match was again good. We've seen it a million times though. These are really the only 3 tag teams. I will say at least they built up the potential, like, you know, tag feud, triple threat, you know, matches, Slammiversary, which is probably what we're gonna get. I'm pretty sure we've seen this exact triple threat tag team match before, but whether we have or not, I don't really care. It's still going to be good. They're still good. It's just they need to have different tag teams. I wouldn't even mind seeing 2 members of the Aces and Eights go after the tag belts. Why the hell not? The tag belts are now on 2 baby faces. So let's have Aces and Eights feud with them for the tag belts, and then have Kaz and Daniels feud with Aries and Roode. Okay, good. And if Roode eventually turns on Aries and ends up with them, then that's whatever. Because they're trying to convince Roode to join. They're basically blaming all the mistakes during this match were blamed on Aries. They tried to help Roode and Aries win. Backfired on them. Chavo and Hernandez retain. Good match. I enjoyed it. I'm fine with it. I'm hoping they follow up with Aries and Roode feuding with Kaz and Daniels. And then, like I said, Chavo and Hernandez end up feuding not with these 2 teams again, but rather go and feud with two of the Aces and Eights members. Remember, didn't Aces and Eights attack them one time? Okay, there you go. So, as far as I'm concerned, that wouldn't be a bad way to... I mean, if Aces and Eights are taking over, they want all the belts, right? So why don't they take the tag belts? They already have the TV and the world title. You know, add to their collection. I'm hoping it's not Garrett Bischoff and Wes Briscoe, but that's probably who you'll see go for the tag straps, not gonna lie. Would rather see Doc and Mike Knox, or Knox, or whatever the fuck his name is, go for him or something like that. I don't even know. Either way, I digress. Matt Morgan is interviewed, giving his thoughts on Hogan's mistakes and all that, and he, you know, says he's gonna go out there and make a statement tonight, and that that if Hogan goes out there and faces Bully Ray tonight, he's going to be making the biggest mistake he's made yet. He is the solution, and basically he ends up coming out offering Hogan protection. Like, I'm going to come out here and kick the crap out of Aces and Eights if you, in return, will give me the number one contendership spot. Not only give me the number one contendership spot, but... you know, hand me that world title match at Slammiversary. That's what I want. If you give me that, I will give you the, you know, I will beat the hell out of Bully Ray for you, and I will be the solution to the Aces and Eights problem. But Hogan says, I'm glad you came out here, but, you know, you're doing this for all the wrong reasons. You just want the title. You're not out here to actually help out TNA as a whole and do it for the right reason. I'm going to do this by myself, whether it kills me or not. You know, you can get out of my ring. You know, so basically he just says, fuck off. I'm not fucking doing that. You know, and stop your bitching, whining, moaning, and complaining. So pretty much, here's how I look at it. Matt Morgan, to me, has always been a good giant. I've always liked the guy. He's actually quite agile for his size. Moves well. Really good wrestler. I enjoy him a lot. I actually would like to see him get the world title at some point. He never quite has gotten there. He's had title matches, but never quite won it. I personally have always preferred him as a babyface, but him as a heel now, it's fine. He's got that profound beard. He looks tough. He looks, you know, and I kind of like that they're giving him mic time. They're talking about the Hogan mistakes and stuff. I like what they're doing with Morgan, personally. And I kind of like that he confronted Hogan tonight and said, if you give me that title match, because all he wants, he's only focused on the World Heavyweight title now. Fuck the Joey Ryan, Matt Morgan tag team crap, because that made no sense from the get-go. You know, he wants that world title. He will take out Aces and Eights, but he's just hungry for the gold. So he just seems like a selfish prick, pretty much, which is fine. And I kind of like that. I'm fine with him, you know, pointing out Hogan mistakes. I would be completely okay with him just, like, hitting the carbon footprint on Hogan one time just out of, like, anger or whatever, or something along those lines. I'm not saying join the Aces and Eights, don't get me wrong, because that's just, there's already enough members, for Christ's sake. But either way, I kind of like this segment. I was fine with it. That's just me. Anyway, Aces and Eights afterwards end up laughing about Hogan, basically saying that, how the hell do they expect that he's, going to be able to beat Bully Ray, and Bully says, I don't want anybody at ringside, I'm going to take care of family business, which is funny. And then, of course, you get Brooke and Hulk, you know, the backstage shipping that you just had to see coming, where Brooke's like, don't go out there, Dad, and he's just like, dude, Brooke, I've got it under control, brother, and then he's like, dog damn it, I had like 10 knee surgeries, I can't do that. That's why I'm just going to stiff him 3 times, hit a big boot, and then a leg drop. Yeah, so we had another matchup here, which was the Knockouts Championship. Velvet Sky retains over Mickie James. Surprisingly, I kind of expected Mickie James to win this match, given the psychology of Velvet Sky being hurt. Mickie James kept attacking the hurt leg throughout the match, not making her... Now, don't take this wrong, she's not a heel here. She's just working the body part to try to freaking win the belt. She's more of just like, I don't care what it takes, kind of Mickie James. It's a little bit different than what she had been before, maybe, but I want her to turn heel. I've wanted her to turn heel for a long time. I've been saying that. Her and Velvet, she always seems like she has this little bit of, like, thing with Velvet Sky. I can, like, just, like, see her kicking the crap out of Velvet Sky all of a sudden one day. Like, I expected here, because Velvet Sky ended up winning with that quick schoolgirl, it was just like, oh wow, okay, here you go, she won via a quick little pin. Mickie James comes back, just attacks her, and then hits her with the belt or something, and there's your Knockouts title feud. a heel, established heel in Mickie James. Because really, what good heel knockouts are there right now, except for Tara and Gail Kim? I mean, really. So you add another heel knockout to this situation with Mickie James, who I think could be a good heel right now, and it would be good to see her and Velvet Sky feud for the belt with Mickie being a full-fledged heel. You know what I mean? I just think that would work out. Match was okay. They played off Velvet's injury throughout it, so the psychology was good with that. I still think Mickie James turning heel is the best-case scenario for TNA right now with that. Again, I know there's not that much thought that's usually probably put into these knockout matches, but I care about everything in wrestling, so I want to see something good happen. Either way, I wasn't upset with this. It was all right. Again, I'm hoping this just fuels it. Even though it wasn't a heel turn tonight, I'm hoping it at least fuels the fire for the future. Let's hope for it. So, we get Bowie Ray coming to the ring in the main event segment. He reads off the list of all the goddamn victims that they've had throughout the entire course of, you know, their existence of Aces and Eights. And he reads off the list, says there's only one name not on this list yet, and that's Hulk Hogan. Hogan comes out to the ring, not doing the standard entrance. He's just coming, Bully, I'm coming for you, you know, that kind of deal. So basically, Bully ends up teasing Hulk Hogan, you know, saying, how's your knee, Dad? I can't wait to beat the living hell out of you. You know, you're not going to fool me. That I know you fear me. I know that you fear the Aces and Eights. You fear that how we threaten you completely. And he says he's the last of a breed, and he will be the one to end Hulkamania altogether. Hogan says it can never die. Hulkamania will never die, dude. And then Bully spits on him. So Hogan has to Hulk up off that. Rip the shirt and, you know, Hulk up and all that shit. Yeah, so what ends up happening is that the standard, Bully goes for the punch, block, one stiff, two stiffs, three stiffs, Irish whip, but then Bully escapes the ring, and the rest of the Aces and Eights come out, they surround the ring, looks like they're about to beat the shit out of Hogan, lights go out, and you automatically know it's gotta be Sting. Sting's in the ring, has his bat pointed toward Hogan. You gotta wonder for a quick second, is he gonna end up just saying, fuck Hogan, I'm not associating myself with you anymore, but he doesn't. He ends up pointing the bat at Bully Ray, and then whacks Bully Ray, and all of Aces and Eights come in. He's just stabbing people with the bat, and then Hogan's just laying stiff rights, and, you know, so they defeat Aces and Eights completely. Those two 50-something-year-old guys, one with a bat and one with a bad knee, who's sitting there against the turnbuckle, just boom, 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 right hands and bat shots, and that's enough to take out all those guys at once. And so Sting and Hogan end up having a little stare down, and Sting leaves the ring, and that's the end of your show. So again, this show, I'll at least say right now, wasn't as Aces and Eights heavy. You felt the difference in the show because all the big names like Angle and all those guys weren't on this show. All the guys they basically took out last week weren't here. You got more of a tag team title, you know, a good match, and maybe more of a progression for a couple of tag feuds, potentially. You got a couple of knockout matches. They got some time on television, which is never a bad thing, especially when Taryn Terrell's on your TV. What else do we got here? We got at least a knockouts match, but a knockouts title match, potentially, hopefully, a heel turn for Mickie James. Still leaving you in the hanging in the balance of the AJ Styles thing. That influence left their presence, which is never a bad thing. Overall, I thought this was a decent show. I wasn't, you know, going nuts over anything really, but wasn't too bad of a show. I'll give it like a B- or so. again, Aces and Eights angle, I've never been a big fan of it. I probably never really will be. But they are stronger. Ever since, you know, lockdown, they've been a lot stronger than they ever were previously. So I'm really not too dissatisfied with with the way the angle's gone the last few weeks. I'm going to guess it's going to be something like Hogan and Sting, whether they're going to, you know, be able to coexist anymore, if they're going to start, you know, being at each other's throats all the time or whatever. I don't know. It seems like the show ends up being all about Hogan and Sting. And it's like, those are two guys that are in their 50s, like, start making it matter more about your younger talent. I'm just hoping one of those two guys isn't the one that faces Bully Ray for the World Heavyweight title at Slammiversary. Because honestly, another guy could use that rub. James Storm, for Christ's sake. Or for Christ's sake, Matt Morgan even. I don't care who the hell faces him. Just let it be somebody of relevance. Or even if Jeff Hardy returns the next couple weeks and faces Bully Ray one more time. That still makes a lot more sense than, you know, Hogan or Sting. Neither one of them really need to go for a world title anymore. Let's just be honest with ourselves here. But anyway, yeah, so overall it was a decent show. I wasn't, like, thrilled with it. No X Division at all tonight, which is pretty disappointing. It was a good show. Not jumping out of my seat about it, but not too bad. So let me know what you guys thought of this week's Impact. Hope you guys enjoyed the video. Be sure to check out NEBW 2012 on YouTube, which is our Backyard Wrestling promotion. Leave me questions for Q&A. I got about 15, 16, so we're less than 10 questions away before I'll be ready to release the Q&A. That's going to do it. Be sure to like, comment, and subscribe for plenty more. Thanks, as always, for taking the time to check it out, and peace.